back to our show on the nature of creativity. I'm here with Anastasia Simes, and we are talking about now your costume design and your theater experiences. Mm-hmm. Tell us more.
Well, I was really fortunate to meet in my life, and that was definitely a life-transforming experience. Pata and Irina Tsukurishvili, founder, director, and choreographer of Cinetic Theater. It is a local theater. You can see them in Crystal City. And that was the most, I would say, earthquake I had in my life. Coming with my energy to this theater and blending it with these people. I would say...
This is the Cirque du Soleil of theater.
It is. And it is a roller coaster of life when you get closer.
Highly creative. We're talking about the nature of creativity.
Absolutely.
And it's that way because?
I think it is the way because they also treat art as a religion. It is a life and death question. There is no rest for anyone, themselves or anyone around them. And this is the most talented people I ever met in my life. So working with them is exciting, unpredictable,
and
extraordinary.
And so in 2011, mm-hmm. we need to say that
yes.
you won the Helen Hayes Award
yes.
for costume design.
Yes.
And were nominated since 2008 for the award.
Yes.
So congratulations for that.
Thank you so much. It was really exciting to be recognized in this field. And.
Your grandfather was a...
Well, he was definitely happy up there to know that.
He was also a costume designer.
He was a set designer.
Set designer.
Yes, but I do both
set
and costumes, and it was my favorite production, Othello, which I did all based on the idea of the triangle, because it is the idea of the triangle between lovers, and triangles also looked like a teeth. Of fate, the heroes were caught in. And this whole thing was very exciting, extraordinary, and interesting to work on.
So I saw one of your set designs, mm-hmm. and I was struck by, and I've never experienced this before, mm-hmm. that your set design was alive, because mm-hmm. I leaned over to Olga, our producer here,
yeah.
and I said, Olga, I've never seen a more, mm-hmm. and I didn't even have the words for it, mm-hmm. so how do you get that aliveness in your set? It was remarkable to have me say that.
I think that we all, Pata and me, we both have background in a cinema education, so I think there is some cinematic attitude toward everything, as well as set. So there is a lot of movement, and I'm trying to give them as much movement as I can because I know they need a lot. So set always moves, rotates, there is something going on. And they also work with it until the very end. Things are never settled until the very last moment. They try to squeeze the last drop of life out of the set.
And what is this concept that they leave something unfinished? How does that
yes,
make it alive?
You know, this is always the work in process until the very opening, and even after that, things still being changed and shifted.
Do you do that in your painting? Does that make painting interesting?
You know, there is an ending to the point, and actually it's a very interesting point, because if you paint your painting for too long, you can kill it.
Yes.
So you need to step out before it happens. And it is very important to know when.
So do you have a different creative process for painting as opposed
yes.
to set yes. design and costume design?
Yes. It is very different because, first of all, set and costume is collaborative, and you have to definitely follow the needs of the production, and you have to follow the needs of cinetic people who are very physical, and you need everything industrial strength for them. They rip the costume, I call them the werewolf people, they rip everything on them. But definitely painting is a very internal process, and there is a kitchen to that, how it happens all.
So describe that process, that kitchen process.
Well, you know, before you come to the canvas, I'm not one of the artists who comes and wait for the inspiration, and then the inspiration comes and you start the painting and you don't know where it ends. Usually in my case, it's very particular. I start to feel restless. I start to pounce like a tiger, and I feel like
Do you have music going?
Yes, music is very important. And then something is coming up, and then I see the whole painting coming in front of me, like in front of my inner side. It is completed.
Really?
Yes, it's like, you know, like this apple. Pictures in the apple.
With Newton.
It comes, yes, in the computer. It comes completely finished. And then I have to really sketch it fast to capture it. Because after that, when I start to look closer into details, they tend to blur and disappear. So I need to capture this while it's happening.
And this is how it's been since childhood?
I think it has been more or less, yes. It became more refined in the last years. I cannot just start painting, I don't know what. I usually have the complete kind of sentence.
So to be a professional artist requires a whole skill set and experience so that you can pop it and do...
Yes. Well, it's like, you know, you cannot come to the orchestra without knowing how to play the piano, for example. So you have to,
So talk about all of that training and that baseline that you have.
There is a very intense education process. I grew up in Moscow, at least it was going on at that time when I was a child. And I spent maybe 18, 20 years just working in the class setting, in the different schools, polishing my skills.
So there's nothing like this in the United States, is there? This type of
in-depth
training?
You have to become professional early on. I think you can start after 10 because it's very rigorous, very intense, sometimes very tough training, and there is not much mercy in it. And
What does that mean?
Well, you know, there is a very harsh requirement. You have to spend 8 hours a day just painting or drawing a model, and then you go home and you have to spend another 6 hours doing your painting and drawing homework.
Do you know other artists that had that type of training in other countries and in other
Well, you know,
colleagues?
I think maybe when you start as an adult, you are more aware of what you're doing. Since I started as a child, and this was the whole system of training, that and very hard concourse to get into good schools, this is how it happens. So you have to be very aware of anatomy, of the composition, of everything that goes into it. And it has to be automatic. You can think about it.
The different mediums. You've studied all the mediums and worked in all of them.
Yes, absolutely.
Talk about that.
Well, you know, you start with as a child, you start with the gouache, and then you move to watercolor because it's a very hard discipline. And I remember, and after that, you move to oils. And I remember switching from watercolor to oils, and my art teacher asked me, "So how do you feel when you look at the palette with the oils?" And I said, "You know, I feel like I want to eat it." And she said, "You know, this is exactly how I felt when I first started to work in oil. Because you feel so excited about the media that you want to eat it."
Do you find other artists are as tactile as you? You use very tactile emotion.
Mm-hmm. Well, I don't know.
It's just natural to you.
It is natural. I never think about it. I remember walking around with my classmates around the city, and we would look at the landscapes. And there is a constant process of work because you analyze, you scan, you think how you would compose it, what colors you would use. And
have you ever done photography?
I'm not good with the photography. Uh-huh. You know, I want to achieve the vision I want, and you cannot do it with photography. You cannot pull things, you cannot move the buildings to do it. So no, I'm not.
So it's not creative enough for you?
I cannot do it. It's really not happening for me, though I admire photography.
So what event in your life pushed your creativity to the limit?
Oh, definitely working in theater on a high speed.
Because?
There is enormous pressure of the deadline, the intensity, the opening night, and then you have to rethink things and change, and that's what definitely makes you come up with a solution because there is no other choice.
So you've had many shows in the United States mm-hmm. and in Russia. Mm-hmm. What is that experience for you? Do you have mm-hmm. Interest in commercial success, artistic mm-hmm. success?
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, again, I was raised in a family of an artist. For example, when buyers will come to my grandfather, I had very bad commercial example because they would come and look at the paintings and they would say, oh, Peter, this is great. And he would say, this is great. Look, it is horrible. Don't you see? This is, I made a mistake there and there, and this is completely outrageous. That was, you know, he couldn't resist all of the self-criticism.
The creative process. That was just more the creative process.
The self-criticism. I mean, nobody took him serious, but it was the death sentence, of course, for the marketing. But anyway, I think that for an artist, it is important to have the full circle of energy. You put something into the world, it comes through you, and then you have to show it to the people. And then at some point, hopefully in alchemical process, it transcends into gold, which comes back to you and allows you to continue.
So what produces your happiest results with your mm-hmm. art?
Well, you know, I would say that examining the whole process of human being alive, I would say that...
That's a big philosophy.
Yeah, I mean, that's what makes me tick. When I think that we are all a battlefields, every day we make a choice, left, right, forward, backwards. And in every instance, we make a choice which creates a fabric of our life. And we're all constantly pulled internally by different contradicting forces. And we, actually the human beings, happen to be in the intersection between angels and beasts. And these two natures fight in them. So for me,
wow,
to see the person in the center of all of that, being torn apart and understanding what makes them to decide this or other way is very interesting. And examining how your clan energy, your family energy affect your relationships and your hopes for the future.
So we're coming to the close, mm-hmm. and I know that you have a painting that's a modern Adam and Eve, maybe just a sentence or
yes.
two about that.
This is very important theme, because now I'm opening the theme how technology affects our life. And I think we are on a new round of temptation, because the new Apple arrived. The new temptation and all beat into that.
The new Apple has arrived.
So
the demon of technology.
Exactly. So the way we find our way out of this virtual labyrinth and find each other, hopefully, that's the whole new challenge of the 21st century.
Thank you so much for sharing
Thank
with
you.
Us the nature of creativity. Mm-hmm. Thank you for joining us. Come back again.